So students, as I mentioned, here comes the questions with respect to what you have learnt, what you know, what you have learnt, with respect to the questions that have so far been asked in the examinations. First, the simplest of all the modes of reproduction is, there are different modes of reproduction, asexual, sexual. Naturally, asexual is simpler than sexual one. Asexual is simpler than sexual one. And in sexual, in asexual also, there are different modes like fission, birding, fragmentation, regeneration, sporulation, etc. Now, which of these is the most simplest? If the choice says birding, sporulation, binary fission, regeneration, and I would go for binary fission. Because it is simplest mode. Why simplest I say is just because it involves the division of the nucleus followed with the division of cytoplasm. The cell cycle is very simple. Daughter cell produced, grows, nucleus divides, cytoplasm divides, daughter cell produced again. And hence it is considered the simplest mode of the reproduction or asexual reproduction. Next, most of the unicellular eukaryotic means organism having a well-defined nucleus, reproduced by multiple fission, binary fission, conjugation or birding. Unicellular, that is protozoans mostly, or certain green algae like cladomonas, etc. They reproduce by how? Again, the simplest mode is binary. So, again, the answer is binary fission. Because each organism wants the simplest to be followed. Simplest to be observed. Like you. If you have to go somewhere, you use the simplest of the path. So also the organism, they have to reproduce, they have to produce their offsprings. So which mode would they use? The simplest possible for them. And there's none but binary fission. Next. The only known unicellular fungi, Saccharomyces cerevisiae, that is yeast. That's the scientific name for yeast. Because, as you know, it is the only unicellular fungi. Asexually reproduces by fungus. Yeast reproduces by sporulation, binary fission, torulation, or budding. The answer is budding. Because in yeast, as yeast grows, a bud develops, and soon the bud detaches. To grow, regrow into a young yeast cell. It's not like that it will keep on producing the chain of buds. If the chain of bud would have been there, I would have taken it as torulation. I would have taken it torulation that had it been like this. Then it would have gone torulation. Next. The first step in all forms of reproduction is an important question. The first step in all forms of reproduction is, if you recall, the cell division in the very first earlier phases we have done, that in cell cycle, there comes two phases. That is, resting phase and the division phase. And resting phase is also called as the synthetic phase. What is the most prime action in the synthetic phase? Because since its resting phase, though called resting phase, is not actually resting phase. That's a highly active phase. Because the first step is division of cell membrane, that will come at the end. Division of cytoplasm, it will follow the division of nucleus. Duplication of chromatin material is the one. That's the correct. Because before division, nuclear material has to be doubled up. If it is not doubled up, that it will cut into half, half into one-fourth, one-fourth into one-eighth, one-eighth into one-sixteenth. By now, that means that the organism would be without nuclear material. If it is dividing asexually. So, the first and the primemost thing is for reproduction to take place, for an organism to reproduce, is to first duplicate its nuclear material. That is, in scientific terms, taken as DNA replication. That means, whatever the amount of the DNA is there in an organism cell, the nucleus of an organism, all that DNA is doubled up. It increases by twice, such that the half remains in one daughter cell, other half remains in the other daughter cell. And with the each daughter cell having half-half, while the parent having the two halves together, the three parental cell, two daughter cells, all three have the same amount of nuclear material. And with the same amount of nuclear material, they show similar characteristics. They show similar characteristics. That is, if I say it is N, N becomes 2N. When divided, it becomes NN, NN and N. All the three are now similar. So, this is the most imperative part, most important part of the cell division to occur, to be completed before the cell divides. Next, the gametogenesis. Gametogenesis means formation and development of gametes. Gametes are sex cells. In male, sperms. In female, ova. So, gametogenesis is one of the processes involved in formation of primary germ cells. That is the correct answer. Because gametogenesis is the formation and development of the sex cells. So, and sex cells are also called the germ cells. Fertilization, no, development of embryo is embryogenesis, and process of embryogenesis is the development of embryo into a complete organism. So, the first is the correct option, formation of the primary germ cell. Next, a protist divides, that is a single unicellular eukaryotic organism, divides every 20 minutes. How much time it will require to produce a colony of 128 cells? Now, we have to find the time from one cell to two cell, 20 minutes, 2 to 4, 20 plus 20, 40, 4 to 8, 60, 8 to 16, 80, 16 to 32, 100, 32 to 64, 120, and then 64 to 128, 140. So what are we left with? The total time is 140 minutes. 145, 140 minutes is what? 2 hour 20 minutes. So the C is the correct option. Because each time when a cell divides, it divides into two. Even when the daughter cells are formed, the two daughter cells, when divide, they would produce four cells instead of two. That means in 40 minutes, a single cell would have produced four cells. Am I right? So that's how we find out the answer for questions like these. And again, these are the questions which have been repeatedly asked every now and then. Either they talk about number of generations. It would be null if I look at number of generations. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 generations would be needed for a single cell to produce a colony of 128 cells. And if it's time, it's how we find out. Next. During a catastrophic change, catastrophic means a sudden. Unexpected. Change in environment. The organism which stands with better chances of survival will be that there are two types of organisms are living there. Those that reproduce sexually and those reproduce sexually. All of a sudden, a catastrophic change, a sudden change has taken place in the environment. Now the question asked is, which of the two would survive, have got better chance to survive? Are sexually reproducing organisms have got better chance to survive? Sexually reproducing organisms have got better chance to survive. Both have got equal chance to survive. Neither of two would survive. Now, if we look, compare the sexual and the sexually reproducing organism, we realize that although sexual reproduction is a complicated form of reproduction, yet is better than asexual. Why I say better? Because sexual reproduction brings up variations. Sexual reproduction brings up variation. That means it is responsible for similarities. Parents are similar to offspring or offsprings are similar to parents. In sexual one. In asexual, parents are clones. That is, they are both structurally and internally, structurally, functionally, internally, genotypically, they are exact replica of the parent. There is no variation. That means there is no variation. No variation means their ability to survive in the dynamic changing environment is comparatively less than those of the sexually reproducing organisms. Catastrophic change means a change is occurring where sexual reproducing organisms have got an upper hand, that is, have a better chance to survive than the asexual reproducing organism. So because, I repeat, sexually reproducing organisms brings up variations necessary for the better chances of survival in the dynamic environment, in the changing environment, have got better chances to survive during the course of catastrophic change than a sexually reproducing organisms. Next, the fungus Alexander Fleming used to produce the first antibiotic, you know, That was produced by Alexander Fleming was none but penicillin. And it reproduces by multiple fission, simple budding, sporulation, multiple budding. Multiple budding means again we are talking of torulation. Now penicillin is a fungus. Penicillin is fungus. That is Penicillium notatum. That was the fungus Alexander Fleming used in order to produce or extract the antibiotic penicillin. How does the question ask, how does it reproduce? Being fungus, either it will produce by budding or by sporulation. And as a fungus, Penicillium reproduces by multiple fission. That is by torulation. The parental hyphae keeps on dividing, dividing, producing buds. So the correct answer is multiple budding. Next. Again an important question. When a moist bread slice is left exposed to air, it develops a colony of bread mold on its surface. Black color, green color, colony on its surface. The whole surface gets covered with this colony. Why? What makes that colony to develop? Spores present in air can be. Gametes present, gametes is not possible because fungi do not reproduce sexually. So gamete is out of question. Zygote is out of questions. There are no floating genes. Genes are the part of the are the segments of DNA. And DNA does not float in water. In air. So the correct option is spores present in air. You keep the bread slice anywhere in your room exposed to the air. The growth of the bread mold would take place provided it is moist. Because as air is present everywhere, so are the spores present in it are there. They would come in, they would land on the bread slice, would reproduce and produce the complete colony of the bread mold. Next. The term clone. Clone, what are clones? Structurally similar but genetically different? No. Structurally different but genetically similar organisms? Structurally different, that's not possible. If you are genetically similar, you can't be structurally different. Both structurally and genetically different organisms of a species, again no. Then you are not a member of the same species. Both structurally and genetically similar organism of a species is the correct choice. Clones are the organisms that are structurally and genetically similar. You know, the first clone animal to be developed was a sheep, Dolly the sheep, in Scotland. And from there onwards, number of these animals have been produced while in plants. As I mentioned during the course of my discussion, cell culture, tissue culture, what is that? That is actually a cloning because each and every cell produced is a clone. Each and every cell produces a clone before it undergoes a differentiation or it undergoes a change in shape or its function. So organisms, I repeat, that are genetically similar, and because they are genetically identical, not similar, genetically identical, they are also structurally identical, and hence they are the clones, like the maternal twins. Maternal twins, you know, the twins which have been produced by the division of the single zygote. Both are identically looking. It's very difficult to identify the two. They are the same sex, same complexion, same height, etc. Those are the clones, not paternal clones. It's the maternal clone twins that are the clones. Next. Which of the following reproduces naturally by multiple fission? Naturally, as we have learned, it's none but is malaria parasite. Malaria parasite is the one that once inside the body, because it is a female and a fleas, it will inject sporozoites. In blood. Now these sporozoites in blood cells in RBC would divide by multiple fission. And will destroy the RBCs. Therefore, the person suffering from malaria and up suffering from anemia with a reducing number of the or reduced number of RBC. So the correct option is malaria parasite. Next. In normal condition, Hydra reproduces by a Hydra can reproduce by fission or it can reproduce by budding. There are two modes. Hydra by budding or by fission. Fission is in the normal condition. Budding only in highly favorable condition. So the question is, the statement is normal condition. Normal condition is fission, so the correct option is B. Had it been in favorable condition, then the answer would have been budding, not fission. Next. Which of the following in an animal kingdom reproduces by fragmentation? The only animal is flatworm. Spirogyra is a plant, sort of question. Roundworm, it doesn't have got any fragments. Hookworm has got no fragments, or it is only the flatworm, which have got the fragments called proglottids, or each fragment is called proglottid. And hence the correct option is none but is flatworm that reproduces by the fragmentation that there are fragments like these. Each of these is called proglottids. When it detaches, it develops into a complete flatworm again. That is flatworm or fragmentation. Next, in sexual reproduction, the chance process is fertilization, because gametogenesis is natural. Once an organism reaches a particular age, germ cells would start producing. Like in humans, a girl starts menstruating at an age of 12 years. Whether she gets involved in the act of reproduction or not, the development of the ovum would take, monthly development of the ovum would start. Same in boys, the development of sperm starts at an age of about 14 or 15 years. Whether the male is involved in sexual activity or not, the development of sperm would start. So we can't say it's a chance process. It is only the fertilization that is a chance process, because if zygote is formed, embryogenesis will take place. Finding a suitable partner, that's not a challenge, that's not a chance. Naturally, an organism has to reproduce, and you can only reproduce with a partner in sexually reproducing organism. So, the correct option comes to fertilization. Next. Again, an important question. The carrier of information for similarity between offspring and parents is that in a cell there are three parts: cell membrane, cytoplasm, nucleus, protoplasm. So there are different parts. Which of these parts is responsible for carrying the information from the parents to the offspring? Cytoplasm, contributed by the parents in development of offsprings. Nucleic acid strands, contributed by the parent cells. Genes, contributed by the parent cells, both cytoplasm and nucleic acid. Actually, the correct answer is genes, because nucleic acid can be there but is not. Why? Because there are two types of nucleic acid, DNA and RNA. DNA are the carrier of genes, not RNA. RNA, according to central dogma, is produced from DNA. You remember, DNA to RNA and RNA to protein, while both these DNA and RNA are the nucleic acids. So, if it is RNA only that is transmitted, then there is no chance of transmission. Hence, the correct option is C, genes contributed by the parent cells. Because these genes keep on working, they remain functional from birth to the death, producing RNAs. And those RNAs continue regulating the synthesis of proteins, which are the structural part of the body. As the functional part of the body being the proteins being the part of enzymes. That's necessary for different metabolic reactions occurring in the body cells. Next. Planaria, a free living flatworm, if cut into four parts, then it would die. The cut part will fuse again to produce a live form. Each cut part will develop into a daughter worm. Each part will continue living as it was after being cut. That means, here is a worm. It has been cut into four parts. Like this. Each of these parts, it would die. They will fuse again and produce a new worm. Or each of these will develop into a complete worm. Or each of them would continue like this. Like, if you remember, in frog development, in the life cycle of frog, there is a stage called tadpole. The development of tadpole into frog is regulated by the hormone thyroxine. If we take out the thyroid gland from a tadpole, no thyroxine production will take place. What we would see, we would observe the tadpole to grow as a tadpole only, without getting transformed into frog. So, they would grow like this, as they are, men retaining the shape of their cut shape. But that doesn't happen. They undergo a transformation, produces a new worm, completely new daughter worm. And that is what the regeneration mode of reproduction is. So, Each part will develop into a daughter worm. C is the correct option. Next, the protists, that is the unicellular eukaryotic organisms. Undergo encystment, that means produce a protective wall around them like this. Here's a cell with a nucleus, a cyst. That you call as cyst, and the process called encystment. Under normal conditions, favorable conditions, extra favorable conditions, unfavorable. It is only in the unfavorable condition they produce the cyst, or they undergo encystment. Encystment, that is the production of the cyst, is called encystment, and that happens only during the course of unfavorable conditions. Next, the animal cell which have property of cellular totipotency, that means they can divide and can produce a complete organ or organism, are germ cells. These are sex cells, now embryonic cells, cells on the embryo, not all. Stem cells, yes. The cells with the property of totipotency are called the stem cells. Flame cells are the excretory cells. Cells responsible for excretion in flatworms. So they have nothing to do with the totipotency. Germ cells are gametes, not possible. Embryonic cells are possible, but not all embryonic cells are stem cells. It is only the stem cells. That's why these days you realize that when a pregnant mother is about to deliver, there are chances where they try to restore the placental part, because that placental part has got some of the stem cells, which in case, if later be needed, be used to treat the disease the child may be suffering from. But that's a precautionary option, or that's not that what you call as involuntary exercise. That's a voluntary option. A mother or a couple may try to do it or not. That's up to them. But it's better if it is being followed. Next. Genetically, germ cells produced by the sexually producing organisms are haploid, diploid, tetraploid, or aloploid. Actually, germ cells are haploid. What happens if this is the somatic cell? Let's say it has two N chromosomes. When it undergoes gametogenesis, produces gametes having NN. In fertilization, when these two NN fuse, they produce two N, which is like parent. Had this division not taken place, what would have happened? 2N, 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 4N. That means the offspring would have been completely different from that of the parent. And successively, every generation, a new type of organism would have been produced, carrying almost double the amount of genetic material as the parent, which is again not feasible. So the gametes, the germ cells, the gametes, they carry half the number of chromosomes that are present in the somatic cells, such that during fertilization, when they fuse, the number of the chromosomes return to normal, half by parents and half by male parent, half by female parent. Next. Asexual reproduction is associated with asexual reproduction. That means It doesn't involve any gamete formation, no fertilization, because gamete formation involves meiosis. And if meiosis is not involved, gametogenesis is not involved, which is a characteristic of a sex reproduction, then the mode of reproduction is mitosis. The parent cell will divide by mitosis. Mitotically, it will divide. As there is no involvement of the formation of germ cell followed with fertilization. Next. So, that's where we have come to the end of some of the questions which have been asked with respect to the asexual mode of reproduction in the plants or in the organisms, plant and animals. Now, in the next class, we'll be talking about the reproduction part both in plant and animals, right? Such that we could finish up or wind up this topic of the reproduction to start with later plant physiology. Thanks.